say, appreciate everybody taking the time to be here today. I know, you know, just talking with individuals today and whatnot, everybody's extremely busy. We got more work right now than we can shake a stick at. So to take the time out today to be able to come commit a whole day with safety really says a lot about everybody. So appreciate y'all being here. So I want to introduce our next speaker, Matt Clarke. Matt began his career in construction after leaving the Army in 1995. He completed pipe fitting, plumbing, and welding apprenticeships, working days and attending trade school at night. He quickly moved up and was promoted to foreman, and then was given the opportunity to transition to the safety profession. Matt has chaired a number of committees and subcommittees for TEXO, ASSP, ABC, CLSA, ADC of America, and the Ocean Construction Safety and Health Conference. He's presented at seminars and conferences both locally and nationally, including Speeding for Companies, TEXO, ASSP, CSLA, ADC of America, RHCA, and A101 on topics covering both technical and soft skills. Please welcome me and introduce Matt Clarke, Safety Manager for TD Industries.
Better them and get that stigma away from them. Even more staggering is 5% of children and 10% of teens suffer from depression. But only about 15% of them are going to speak up. Statistics show us that about 90% of adults have children, and the average is 2.4. So we got 150 people in here. Quick math is going to tell me 135 have kids. That's going to be about 310 kids represented in this room, give or take. About 310 kids. If 5% are having, or 5% of kids and 10% of teens have suffered from depression, then we're looking anywhere from 15 to 30 children represented in this room that are suffering from depression. And so you really got to ask yourself, is it your kid? And I'll tell you, you probably don't know it. They tend to hide it really well, especially teenagers. They mask it. They don't really want to talk about it very well. It's, like I said earlier, it's not an easy conversation to have. And so you really have to reach out and be involved in their lives. You have to dig into them, right? Simply asking them at the end of the day, hey, how was your day today? It's not enough. You have to get into their lives. Ask them, are you being bullied at school? Do you have good friends that you can talk to? How's your relationship with your teachers? How's your relationship with your girlfriend or boyfriend going? Really get into those tough questions with them and start to see how their emotional life is going for them. If they have a diary, read it. If they have social media, invade it. Get into it and figure out what they're doing. A lot of parents say, well, I don't want to do that because I'm invading my child's privacy. They're under the age of 18, they don't have privacy. Your role as a parent is to get them to the age of 18 safely, right? So get them there, whatever you gotta do. I would much rather invade my kid's privacy than have to bury him because I didn't. So make those tough decisions, get involved in their lives, and ask those tough questions of them, okay? All right, some even more depressing statistics is suicide. It is the second leading cause of death for ages 10 to 24, right? So think about that for a minute. If you got kids or grandkids, brothers, sisters, nieces, nephews in this age range, second leading cause of death, right? Heartbreak. I can't imagine having to bury my child from that. It's the 10th leading cause of death overall in the entire United States. So when you figure in every single person in the U.S., 10th leading cause of death is suicide. Our industry is hit pretty hard with that. Every 11 minutes there's a victim of suicide. Sorry, I got our industry down here a couple bullet points later. Every 11 minutes there's a victim of suicide. I said on the previous slide that people suffer from depression. They are a victim of suicide. We like to kind of stigmatize people whenever they commit suicide and say, man, that was selfish. I can't believe they did that. But in reality, somebody that's in their normal state of mind doesn't just choose to kill themselves, right? And so they're suffering from a mental condition, and it is a medical condition. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And unfortunately, they died from that medical condition, right? So we need to end that stigma around suicide also and not blame people that have killed themselves. When someone dies of cancer, we don't say, man, I can't believe they got cancer, right? They died of a heart attack. I can't believe they let that happen. They died of a heart attack. Suicide's the same way. So we need to realize that and really put our efforts into preventing that. Right? 50% of people know somebody that committed suicide. So show of hands, who knows someone that's committed suicide? Check that out. You're not alone, right? If your hand didn't go up, I'm very happy for you. It's very tragic when it happens. And the weird part of it, and we'll talk about this again later on, is that most of those people that committed suicide, you had no idea, right? It's like, I can't believe that happened. I never would have guessed that. And it's because people suffering from depression do a really good job of hiding. So I'm no different. I've had my fair share of people that have committed suicide in my life. When I was 16, my brother's best friend, Brent, decided to shoot himself in the head. No idea why. Brent was a happy, outgoing kid. We hung out with him. He came to our lake house growing up. He was skiing with us every weekend during the summer. Stayed at our house all the time with my brother. brother, and one day just decided to shoot himself in the head, and that was the end for his life. After that, I was in the Army. We were in a foxhole on the live fire range, so it was me and one other person in the foxhole. They gave me 3 rounds at a time, because we're privates and we're stupid, so you don't get a whole magazine at one time. So you get 3 rounds, you fire those 3, you wait for everybody to fire their 3, and then you get 3 more. So I shot my 3. The guy next to me, which I don't remember his name, what is called Private No Name, but he fired 3 shots, spun his rifle around, and put the 3rd shot in his mouth. I don't recall what his face looked like before he shot himself, but I'll never forget what he looked like after. A lot of yelling from the drill sergeants to get the hell away, just a total shock. I had stuff on me that nobody should ever get on them. After him, my wife's uncle Jerry, at the age of 63, for whatever reason, decided to hang himself in the bedroom one day. He was married. My aunt and his wife is actually coming down this weekend because we're going to a concert. We're going to take Rolling Stones next weekend, or next weekend with her. So she's coming down this weekend. But so he's married, got a great wife. His son Justin lives with him. He's got another son, Shane, and a daughter, Candace, and his grandkids. They all love him. He gave Justin some money, said, hey, go run over and get us some chicken for lunch. Justin left, came back, bedroom door was locked, Justin kicked the door in, and Shane was in there dead. So unfortunately, Justin found his dad dead at the age of 63. And that really tore Justin up. And 1 year later, on the anniversary of that, cousin Justin decided to kill himself. A lot of times that happens. It tends to spread a little bit. There are some links to genetics and depression. And unfortunately, when one person chooses it in their life, then a lot of times other people around them will suffer that same fate as well. But I had Superintendent Sean Hembro. I know, Jamie, you know Sean, the car guy, might know Sean. Great guy, he's gone through a rough divorce and decided to kill himself. And then I had another friend that I worked with many, many years ago, the pipe fitter, Tim. I don't have a picture of Tim, so I got Bob Builder. But Tim just decided to end his life one day. So, unfortunately, in my life, I have 6 people that I've known that have killed themselves. Some of them extremely close to me, some of them acquaintances. Right? So it's tough. Most of them hit me in one way or another. So construction workers. This slide says we have the third highest occupational rate of suicide. Unfortunately, I didn't update that because they just came out with new stats about a month ago. And right now, the CDC says that we have the highest rate of occupational suicide in America. Construction workers. Some stats will see it has another second, some are third. No matter what you see, it's bad, right? And there's a lot of reasons for that. Construction is still dominated by a alpha male mentality. So there's a lot of tension on a job site, a lot of headbutting on a job site. It's always stressful. I've never had an owner walk up to us and say, hey, y'all are doing a great job, let me give you an extra month on your schedule, right? So we're always behind the gun. And there's a lot of travel involved, so people are away from their core support groups. So you add in stress, arguments, and being away from family, and it just puts people into a bad mindset, and if they're already suffering from a mental health issue, then it can just be worse for them. So why don't we talk about it? If it's so common, right? I told you how many people are sitting in this room are suffering. Why don't people reach out and get the help? Well, it's not easy, right? It's just not something that we really want to go walk out and talk about. I was driving to work a couple, maybe 10, 12 months ago or so, and I heard this song on the radio. I'm going to play the first verse to it. It really kind of settles why we don't speak about it. Line number 2, everybody's life is perfect except yours. Hey, how are you today? Good, you? Good, right? And that's kind of the side of the morning. I mean, think about it. When someone walks past you and they say, how you doing? Whether it's a stranger, a coworker, family, friend, what's your standard answer? Right? I tell you, mine's fantastic. Right? That's generally what I say to everybody. Fantastic, how are you? Sometimes I'm amazing, sometimes I'm great. Sometimes if I was any better, I'd have to sit on my hands and keep clapping. But whatever the case may be, rarely do I really tell them what's going on in my life, right? Because that's not a normal conversation. I go to, a couple jobs ago, I go to Lowe's almost every single morning for the project that I was on. And I got kind of know people there, you know, 7 o'clock in the morning, they're just opening up, very few people there. You know, I got like 3 cash registers, one's usually open, right? And so it's always the same one or two people that are running those registers. And so, you know, they recognize, and I recognize them, right? And so one day, I walked up, this little lady working, and I was like, hey, how are you today? She said, oh, I'm not doing good. Because my granddaughter ran away. We've been raising her because my son's in prison again for drugs. And, you know, my husband died about a year ago, so, you know, I'm a single grandmother trying to raise my teenage daughter. She's kind of running with games, and I just don't know what to do. And I'm sitting there going, like, this is extremely uncomfortable. But the fact is I sat there and I listened to her, and I said, can I pray with you? And so I stopped and I prayed with her right there in Lowe's cash register line, right? And I walked out the store feeling great that I had allowed her to express herself and gave her some encouragement and prayer, and still feeling incredibly awkward about the whole thing. But, you know, it was weird, right? If a stranger just decides to open up to me one day, that's not something that we in society deal with very well. And the weird thing is that it's even harder to do that with your loved ones, right? Because they're looking at you saying, why are you dealing with this? I don't understand, you know? So it's just not something we're accustomed to talking about. I told you earlier, depression is a medical issue. Okay. Whether it be misfiring neurons, synapses that aren't clicking right, chemicals in the brain that are mixed up, something in the brain is causing that, right? And so when people are suffering from depression, most people need medical treatment for it. Stanford and the Mayo Clinic have both done studies on this. So these are scans on the brain. They looked at glucose intake levels of the brain. Don't ask me what that is. I go back to caveat number one, I'm not a doctor. But it's something that deals with happiness, right? And they've actually shown the difference between people that are happy and people that are suffering from depression. And it is truly a medical condition that is visible in scans. And Stanford actually took, excuse me, the Mayo Clinic took that a step further, and they scanned somebody that just won the lottery. Right? Wow. It's a real condition. So when people are suffering from depression, and you're not, and you're sitting there thinking, well, I don't understand. You're right, you don't. It's because you're not going through the same thing as they are. Right? There is a possible genetic link. I mentioned that during the suicide. A lot of times depression runs in the family. It's not really proven out very well yet. They're still doing studies on it. But they do show some correlation where if someone in a family has depression, oftentimes other people will. But again, there's not real good direct evidence of that yet. So I said most of the time people will need some type of medication because it's a medical condition. For the purpose of this presentation, I've made up two terms, neurological and situational. And the reason why is because there's a lot of different things that cause depression. So when I mention a neurological depression, that's somebody that's got the chemical imbalance. That's somebody that's got PTSD, where it's drastically affected the way that their brain triggers. It's a deep-rooted something going on in the brain, and it's something that most likely is going to end up being medicine. Situational depression is a little bit different, and that's somebody that may have had something go wrong in their life. Right? A major trauma. They may have been attacked. They may have lost a loved one. It could be something going on with their daughter or their granddaughter that they're raising all by themselves, right? anxiety. It's my tell me if that's anxiety or not. Yeah. And it's 29% to 72%. So that's that situational depression, right? They don't really know how to deal with everything that's going on in their life at the current moment, and they end up depressed from it. Science is showing that even people that have some type of a situational depression usually have a little bit of an underlying medical condition going on as well. But under normal circumstances, their brain can overcome that, and so they normally don't suffer from depression. But whenever situations get bad, or they get forced into an awkward position, then they can end up triggering depression for them. There's billions of things that go on in our brain each second, and all of those things have to line up just perfect in order for us to function properly. And so when any of those go wrong, then we can end up with something off. Sad is a little bit different. This is seasonal affective depression. This is somebody that is good during the happy, sunshiny months of the year, and they suffer from depression during the gloomy winter months of the year. There's some studies going on about it. It's an odd phenomenon. I don't really like that acronym, SAD, and we'll talk about that as the why here in just a few minutes. So we said what depression is. Let's talk about what it is not. It is not imaginary, right? People aren't just thinking that they have depression. People suffering from depression truly are. So when you're dealing with someone that's depressed, you gotta put yourself into their shoes and try to understand where they're coming from with it. They're not just happy, right? It's not something they can will away, right? If people could get rid of depression just by wanting to, no one would suffer from depression, right? No matter how good their lives are, they're suffering from depression. It's not something they can just say, hey, go away and be better today. It doesn't work like that. It's not a sign of weakness. This is one of the big reasons why people don't want to speak up and seek help. They don't want to be seen as weak or lazy. It's nothing to do with that. It's a medical condition, right? If people get cancer, you don't say they're weak, right? People break a bone, you don't say, you're a weak individual, right? It's a medical condition going on. It's not a sign of weakness. And so I told you I didn't really like the acronym SAD. Depression is not sadness. A lot of people that consider themselves depressed, or that are depressed, consider themselves to be a happy individual. And a lot of people that you consider to be a happy individual suffer from depression. It's shocking whenever you find out that a lot of people are depressed. Now, some of them you can look at and just know you're depressed. But for the most part, a lot of people hide very well, and they consider themselves happy. Depression is not an emotion. It's not happiness or sadness. It's a medical condition. And so the best way that I kind of equate that is it's like this little black cloud in the back of somebody's brain. It's constantly there, constantly just shouting little stupid thoughts at them. So even if their emotion is in the right place, their medical condition is not. Okay? What do all these people have in common? Every one of these people died from depression. Some from outright suicide, some from drug overdoses. Probably recognize some of these: Marilyn Monroe, Ernest Hemingway, Robin Williams, Mac Miller. There's a ton of them up there. All these people, died suffering from depression. It's a lot more common than what you would think. Everybody know who Robin Williams is?
Yeah.
Would you ever thought that people were depressed? Right? So you can't just look at somebody and say, oh, they're happy, they're not depressed. That's why we have to get those tough questions and really start asking what's going on in life. So they got this hashtag basic depression. I'm not gonna play this whole next video for you, but every September they have a big kick of tell us who's depressed, right? It's all over social media. You'll see people posting about themselves or their family members using hashtag basic depression or hashtag suicide. I went through last September and just searched that hashtag and picked up a whole bunch of pictures and stories off of it. What I want you to look at out here is the variety of people. Women, men, young, old, fat, thin, black, white, Mexican, Asian. Doesn't matter what it is. Doesn't matter who you are. Every demographic can suffer from depression and suicide. Thank you. Vitamin D soaking up the sun rays and creating vitamin D for yourself. They actually make light boxes that psychologists will give out to people that are suffering from MDD, major depressive disorder. And it does the same thing. It's just a fun little box, and it creates vitamin D in your system, and that helps quite a bit. Mirror talk. Simply sitting in the mirror and telling yourself that you're worthy. I'm not one of those people who likes to talk in the mirror, but I did see this and I thought about that. And yeah, I'll remain with this. I don't know how far down this would be. I do love myself, but it's not really one of the ones that I would think about very quickly, right? Spending time outside, breathing in some good fresh air, going for a nature walk, listening to the birds sing. It's been proven that it helps out quite a bit. Made a budget. I told you situational depression is a real thing. The stress of financial troubles can absolutely cause you to go into depression, so simply making a budget and sticking to it can help with that. Getting a regular sleep pattern, if your circadian rhythm is not correct, then it's a lot easier for your brain to start misfiring, right? So if you want to really take care of your wellness, go to bed at the same time every night, wake up at the same time every morning, even if it's a weekend, a holiday, a vacation, try to keep that same general regimen. Your body will love you for it. Eating healthy, you know, whenever you eat a bunch of fat and greasy food, you just kind of feel kind of blah, bogged down, and you eat some good fruits and veggies, you feel uplifted. That goes a long way with your mental well-being. And then therapy pets. A lot of people are really good at a pet. Even something as simple as a goldfish gives people that are suffering from MDD a little bit of encouragement because they're able to take care of another life. And so it kind of gives them a little bit of mental encouragement. Hey, I can take care of this life. I should be able to take care of my own as well. But the thing with pets is they can be really good, right? So you really got to decide what you're looking for, right? If you're wanting a pet that you're just to take care of and keep alive, get a fish. If you want something that's going to come and love on you every day, don't get a cat. You really got to decide what you're looking for in life, right? Get the right pet. And then understand that you're probably going to outlive your pets, right? This is mine. This is Lucy. I got three. Lucy, Charlie Brown, and Linus. Lucy is my favorite of the three. Don't tell Charlie Brown and Linus that. But every day I come in, and this is Lucy. She literally just flops over and waits for me to start rubbing her belly, right? If I'm not in a great mood, she's snuggling on me. Wherever I go, she follows me around. She's mine. I'll be my wife and my son. She's decided that she's my dog. But understand, if you're getting a pet, you're probably going to outlive that pet, unless you get one of those tortoises or a parrot or something. Right? They live forever. And that's a totally different thing that you got to figure out. If you're a single person, you have a pet, and you outlive it, what's going to happen to it, right? So you got to kind of think of those things. But be prepared if you're getting a pet as a therapy pet because you have depression. What's going to happen whenever it dies, right? So it may or may not be the right thing for you. And then, you know, obviously, you don't want to totally just destroy your pets. So, it's kind of weird because people that are in a good place in their life and they suffer from depression, you look at it and you think, why are you suffering from depression, right? You have no reason to be sad. You shouldn't be depressed. You live a great life. I've seen your family. I've seen your house. You have a great job. You should golf wonderfully. Why are you depressed? All that does to someone is make them feel guilty and depressed. It doesn't solve their depression, right? So we need to figure out how to be helpful to people without making them worse off. You want to be supportive, but be their supportive. If you've ever studied the five love languages, they're really great. You can use this with depression. Everybody has a different type of love in their life. You can look this up, five love languages. If you're married, I highly encourage you to figure out what your spouse's love language is, because it's probably not the same as yours. And if you're trying to give them your love, they may not be extremely receptive to that. So figure out what their love is and treat them accordingly. But if you're dealing with someone that's depressed, you really got to figure out what they need, right? Going up and trying to ask a bunch of questions about them and getting them to talk, if they're not a talking person, if their love language isn't word of affirmation or communication or anything like that, they're going to feel attacked, right? They're going to feel like they've boxed them into a corner, like they're in a witness stand, right? And so that's not the best thing for them. So you really got to figure out how people want the support and give them support that they need, not the support that you want to give. So why does this matter to us? We're safety professionals. What does this really have to do with our profession, right? And some of you aren't safety professionals, by the way. I really appreciate y'all coming out to safety day, right? You can use the same stuff with your family, with your friends, with your coworkers. First and foremost, it matters because of our profession, right? I say we're chief professionals, SAT, safety, health, environmental. You may hear DHS, all different words that they use to, or different orders that they put that in. I choose chief because safety is the most important thing for me. Health is second to that, and then if I can save the environment, awesome, but, safety, health, environmental. Health is not just industrial hygiene. It's mental health, it's the health of your workers. You should want your people, your coworkers, your loved ones, everybody, to be in the best mental health they can be. And this goes right along with that SAT profession. Cost. The cost of depression is staggering. I don't know the numbers for 2020, but in 2019, depression cost the United States economy $325 billion, with a B. The vast majority of that comes directly out of our company's bottom line. So let's say about 5% of that $325 billion is suicide costs, funerals, medical, things like that, right? The other 95% of that $325 billion is split up between direct medical costs and lost productivity and absenteeism. So the lost productivity and absenteeism, well, that's 100% hitting our bottom lines. The direct medical costs, though, most of our companies are in these self-insured medical programs now, right? And so we pay those costs out of our bottom line. Well, as an SAT professional, part of our job, we tend to fall under the risk management umbrella, and that's all about maximizing profits sometimes, right? What if you can knock off some of that cost and help improve the bottom line of your company? This can have a major impact in your organization. People suffering from depression are 41% more likely to have an unintentional injury than people that don't suffer from depression. People suffering from depression, 41% more likely to have an unintentional injury. Who in here still gets graded in your jobs based off of your numbers? Right? We all like to say we don't, but in reality, if you've got a ton of injuries, right, it just doesn't look good for us. If you can knock off a few of those just by working on mental health, right, that's great for your job. And then finally, this one is said for people. The WHO, World Health Organization, and the CDC both say that depression is the leading cause of disabilities. The WHO says worldwide, CDC says in America. Now, this is one of those conflicting studies. NIOSH says that it's arthritis, and they list depression as second. CDC says that it's the other way around. I don't know. We're going to say it's the leading cause of disability in America. It takes a major toll on us, right? And then finally, and most importantly, we're human beings, right? We should care about each other. We should do whatever we can to help each other get through their time. So there's lots of resources out there. You can go talk to your medical professionals. Almost every company has an employee assistance program. You should know that phone number. I have it programmed into my phone. I've given the same talk from a 5-minute toolbox talk on a job site to hour-long presentations for about the past 15 years. And I've had numerous people walk up to me after this and say, hey, can I get that EAP phone number? So it's great to have a handy program in your phone so you can give it to them. I've also done the toolbox talk for superintendents and family teams. Why did you choose that for a safety meeting topic? So you'll get that sometimes too, right? National Suicide Hotline, 1-800-273-TALK. President Trump signed a new bill in August of next year. We have 988, the national three-digit phone number. That's been the National Suicide Prevention Hotline. If you're not one who likes to talk, me, right? They also have a text crisis hotline. You can text a keyword to 741-741 and get free text counseling services. I say a keyword, you can literally send them anything you want. Health, press, at home, dining, happy, whatever you want, it's just still send the same thing to you. And they're going to reply back and say, hey, you know, we understand you need some help, what can we help with? And they'll give you free text counseling services back and forth, have as long as the conversation with you as you want. So that's a great one to keep handy as well whenever people are talking to you and say, hey, man, Texas phone number, they can give you some support, right? NAMITexas.org is a national agency for mental illness, I believe it is. And then friends, family, anyone, just talk to people, right? If you're suffering, get out there and talk to people. I always tell everybody, if you don't want to talk to somebody, you know, call me. My phone number is 214-870-7318. I would much rather hear about your condition than read about you in an obituary. So feel free to just reach out to a stranger sometimes. If you want my number later on, give me my card, but reach out to me if you want to call. Okay. So some final thoughts, I have three of them to wrap up. First off, never walk away from a red flag. If you see somebody that you think is suffering, that you think they have an issue, talk to them. About a year ago, I walked past one partner, said, man, how are you doing today? But he was outside for a few minutes, so took him outside. Man, you don't have to tell me what's going on, but if you need somebody to talk to, I'm here for you. I knew he was going through the divorce at the time, right? But he kind of unloaded on me that, you know, his wife being evil to him about his kids, trying to keep his kids from him, and so I sat there and just had another 30-minute conversation with him. And, oh, man, listen, if you're ever in a bad place, you just need somebody to talk to you, feel free to call me anytime, day or night. I don't care. I'd rather talk to you than read about you later on. That Saturday, about 11 o'clock at night, he texted me. He goes, are you available? I said, absolutely. You want to call or text? He goes, I just want to text back and forth. We had about a 45-minute text conversation. Monday, I go in and like, man, that was huge. I really, really appreciate that. He's a great partner, right? He's a guy. He's got a little bit of PTSD in the Marines and the war. So he's got the PTSD, he's gone through a bad divorce. Wife's trying to keep his kids away from him. Don't miss those red flags. Just reaching out and offering to be there for somebody can literally save a life. There's no temporary problems in life that are worthy of a permanent solution. I told you I got a kid, he's 14. Every chance I get, I say this to him. There's no temporary problems in life worthy of a permanent solution. Right? No matter what you're going through, it's going to end at some point. Killing yourself to get rid of that problem is not a good answer for it. And then finally, why is this important to me? Well, I told you I've been giving this talk for 15 years. 5 minutes to an hour, varying about how long it's been. Last year, January of last year, I finally decided that at the age of 43, I was going to go to my doctor and admit that for the vast majority of my life, I've suffered from depression. And so I did. And that was really weird because that was the first person that I ever told. When I told my wife, who, by the way, has known me ever since I was 8 years old, she's my best friend's little sister, totally different story. But whenever I told her, after 35 years of knowing me, that I suffered from depression, she's like, man, I've kind of seen some things of it, but it just didn't happen. I didn't really figure it out. And so I went to the doctor, and I got on medications. If I could go back and just slap the head out of 15-year-old me, I would, because, man, my life's gotten so much better, right? If I could go back to my 20s and 30s and tell that dude, hey man, quit being a jerk and go get on some meds, I would. Because my life is just so much better now. Right? So she adjusted my medication a couple times. I can tell you that right now, I am in the best place I've ever been in my life. So in August of last year, August 2021, I went back to her for a normal checkup. And at that point, I decided that I would admit my deepest, darkest secret. And that's the fact that whenever I was 14, I attempted suicide. And no one knew. No one. I told my parents that I was in a bad accident and got rushed to the emergency room, and they never knew that it was on purpose. Had a lot of treatment out of that, but it was for medical issues. But they never knew that I'd done that on purpose. And then whenever I was 15, I decided to try to kill myself again. And fortunately, before I took all the pills that I took, I drank a whole lot of beer, and so I woke up in a nasty puddle of vomited pills instead of being dead. And so when I admitted that for the first time to anybody other than me, my creator, retracting from myself because that was just so hard to say out loud that I tried to kill myself. But it did wonders for me inside. So then in September, I hired on a TD, September last year. By the way, I spent 13 years with Colt McGangle, fantastic company. Spent 13 years with McCarthy, I them, fantastic company. Nothing has to say about any of them. I'm with TD now, fantastic company. They really fit my personality a whole lot better than where I was. Nothing bad to say about any of the other two companies. So I started with TD, and they got this whole servant leadership culture, right? Leading from the heart, talking about love. And so my first quarterly meeting for my department for manufacturing, our vice president comes up to me and says, hey, you know, I need you to do about a 5-minute safety presentation. Is there anything you want to talk about? I was like, hey, listen, I got a great presentation in 5 minutes to talk about mental health, right? With the pandemic going on, it's the perfect time for it. He's like, I've never done that before. Yeah, sounds great. So at the end of that, I told you it's hard to do this, right? And so at the end of that, I kind of realized that for the past 15 years of doing these talks, I've been a hypocrite, right? So I'm telling people they need to go seek help, but I've never admitted to anybody else. I tell people, hey, you got to talk about it, but I've never told anybody else, right? And so in that presentation, I decided to tell them, by the way, this is important to me because I tried to kill myself twice as a teenager. At the end of that presentation, I had 4 people come up to me and said, man, listen, I really need to hear that, and they got the AV phone number from me. So 4 partners in manufacturing, suffered in silence, got the phone number, right? That was huge. If I could save one life from all of this, then this is a total win in my book, right? So that's why I do this. It's important to me because I don't want anybody else. I can't imagine if my parents had to bury me when I was a teenager. I grew up in a fantastic home. My dad was a deacon in our church. Right? Parents had 3 kids, 2 dogs. Doesn't get any more American than that, right? Dad was a deacon, he coached Little League, brought us all up wonderfully. Happy ass family, and I tried to kill myself. What is that all about? Right? 2020, I suffered a really, really bad year for no reason whatsoever. I was at a great point in my career. I got the wife, my wife is just stunning, right? I promise you, I'm married up, right? My kid, outstanding young kid, we homeschool, we do everything with them. Love my family, I've already started one of my 3 dogs. I had no reason to be depressed. 2020 was a really rough year in my life, and depression really weighed heavily on me at that point, which is why I went to soft treatment in 2021. There's no reason for it. I told you about the little black cloud. I know that because I suffered from it, right? And no matter how good my life is going, I've just got this thought back there saying, you're not good enough. People don't like you. You know, you're not doing it, right? But I know I'm worthy. I know I'm good, right? So you just have to get past that and start talking to people. Why is this important to me? Because I don't want anybody in here to have to bury a loved one from suicide. So that's my story, right? Told you I used humor to get past my uncomfortableness. Any questions?
Author.
Yes. Appreciate you. Thank y'all very much for allowing me to come here and hear your talk. The left QR code, if you want to scan it, I got a left arm on the wall over here. If you want to get it from the end, I'd love to have you. Construction Industry Association for Suicide Prevention, CIASB. They've got all kind of great materials out there for free. They do the stand-up for suicide prevention every year. Tiffany Dunn was kind enough to invite me out to come do a speech on one of their projects a month ago. They did a stand-up for stand-up, right? Really great topic. So if you need any materials, CIASB.org, I believe it is.
It's Construction Industry Alliance for Suicide Prevention. And they put a stand-up week together, and they on their website, they have all the materials that you would need to do a stand-up. But I also will offer, if Matt, you're available, I attended that one at J.E. Dunn. That was really phenomenal. They did this really cool exercise. Is anybody with J.E. Dunn in the room yet? Anybody here yet? Marco's not here yet. They did this really cool thing where they took their logo.
I tried to get that every time.
Yeah. They took their logo and emptied it out, and they had different colored polka dots, stickers. And those stickers said, you know, if I wanted to attempt suicide, if I had a family member that attempted suicide, so on and so forth. They had, what was it, Matt, 6 or 8 different colors, I think. And had everybody that had congregated for the meeting come up and put a colored sticker that reflected whatever instance they had to cover that logo up, and they were going to present that logo just to show awareness of how many of us actually deal with that. And I thought that was phenomenal. As a matter of fact, I brought it up at the ABC meeting that I had the other day, because ABC has got a product that they're going to be bringing out to bring attention to.
Yeah, we're trying to have your marketing and kind of
content. Yeah, yeah. But it's phenomenal to come up with an idea like that. So, Matt, I really appreciate you sharing those experiences, your life experiences with us, your information with us. It takes a lot for you to come stand up and kind of talk about it and share that. But I think it really rings true with all of us. So thank you very much. Thank you, John, for introducing Matt with us. So, again,